Okay. Good evening, everybody. Glad we've got some folks in church this evening. Not as many as the morning. Always have less in the evening than we do in the morning. Luke 18. Let's pray, Lord, thank you for the 18th chapter of Luke, the beginning of it. Now we're going to read about prayer. And we need to know about prayer. People don't come to prayer meeting. We'd have a few here today, and we ought to have a lot more. And so let us teach us about prayer tonight. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Starts out and it says, and he spake a parable unto them. You know, parable's a story, but teach you a lesson. Okay. To this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Okay. So this this little parable is going to teach us today that we ought to pray and not to faint. And if you pray, you won't faint. People are always fainting. Every day I have numerous people that text me or call me or talk to me personally at church, here at the office at church or whatever. And they're at wit's end. They've got problems in their life, and they're looking for someone to talk to. They're looking for someone to console them. And the truth of the matter is, when the Lord in this parable, it says, and he spake a parable unto them, and said, this man always to pray and not to faint. Did you know if we pray, and the Bible tells us to pray without ceasing, we can be in constant fellowship with the Lord. Now, first of all, a lot of people, the reason that they can't be in fellowship with God because they're not saved. How are you going to be in fellowship with God if you're not a born-again Christian? You've got to be in the family. If you're a stranger, now you can become of the family. I just was at a funeral Monday night, and one of the children, one of the daughters of the deceased, and she's not a kid herself, but her dad died, and it was at the viewing on Monday night, and 90 years old, and her mother died 3 weeks ago, about the same age, 90 years old, and I got any cough drops in here. Hope I do. Cough drops there. Cough drops there. Did you notice any cough drops in that cupboard? I don't think so. I think I gave them all away. Oh well. Excuse me when I cough, folks. I should have stopped and got some cough drops on the way here. Anything down there? No, look like it. But anyway, she made the statement. Oh, man, they got in here something smelling. Right. Someone gave their cigarettes in. I stuck them up in here. I could smell it. Tobacco. Someone surrendered their cigarettes. I got to get that out of there after a while. Whew. Cigarettes smell nasty, you know? You suck them in and suck them down in your lungs and give you cancer and all that. But anyway, she said, Pastor Varga, I'm an orphan. Her mother died 3 weeks ago, and her dad died this last week at funeral yesterday, viewing on Monday night. And I said, I told her this, I've got someone that'll adopt you. She looked at me like that, you know. And I said, my Heavenly Father will adopt you. My Heavenly Father will. Boy, you want to get in a big-time family. You want to be in an elite family. You want to be in a family of royalty. Get into the family of God. Amen? Yeah. And he'll adopt anybody. By the way, that's why we get it. That's why we're saved. We're adopted in the family of God. We're born again and we're joint heirs with Christ. Amen? Isn't that good? But you have to be in the the presence of God. I feel sorry for people there. You know, there's some people that they can't stand to be alone at all. They've always got to be in a group. They've got to go to a bar, or they've got to go to a party, or they've got to be somewhere where there's people around, because they can't stand to be alone. But you see, when you're a true Christian, when you're in the family of God, He's always present with you. I mean this too. I'm as honest as the day is long on this. The most comfortable I feel ever is when I'm alone with God. That's the most comfortable I feel. I don't have to look for someone. I don't have to go to the mall and try to sit down and talk with someone. I don't have to go to the movie show. I don't go to dirty Hollywood movie shows anyway. They ain't no better than they ever been. Christians 25 years ago, they never went to the movie shows. Not Christians, they got the movie show even in their house, sad to say. I'm so sick and tired of Christians telling me. Christians try to get me to go to movies with them, you know, Hollywood movies. I ain't interested in all that junk. It doesn't interest me. Now, I'll watch The Burning Hell like we watched here Sunday afternoon. Or an enactment of the Bible, and hard to get them, but I like to get the ones, of course, that have the Bible that they're using as the text, the King James Bible. But God wants us to be with Him, and you can be with Him. First of all, you have to be saved, and you have to be right with Him. So let's go on here and look at this prayer teaching here in Luke 18. They speak a parable on them this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint, saying, there was in a city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. Now, that's a pretty sorry judge, you know. I'd be that, probably what we might call these days, or maybe not really not these days, but back in the cowboy days, you'd call him a hanging judge. A hanging judge. A judge that didn't fear God and didn't care about man. That's a bad judge. I want to. If I have to go before a judge, I want to have a judge that is just. I've never had to go before a judge to be tried. I've never had that. Got in a fight once in Allen Park when I was a teenager from Detroit, and. I had to call my buddy. His dad had money, and he bailed me out for $250. I was in jail for about an hour, just in a holding tank. I never had to go to the judge, so it was just forfeit $250, and you're through. I didn't have to see a judge on that. I was fighting. I mean, I wasn't contesting that. But you wouldn't want to go before this judge. Didn't fear God, and neither regarded man. And there was a widow in the city, and she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine adversary. Now, she had someone that was doing her wrong, and she was just a poor widow. A widow lady. And back in those days, back in the Bible days, widows, if their family didn't take care of them or the church didn't take care of them, they didn't have no welfare to go to or anything like we have now. They didn't have a safety net in the community or in the government, which we have today. And we ought to be there. We've got a great safety net here in America. They're flooding over the borders from Mexico and all the rest of Central America, getting in here to get in our safety net, you know. And we got right now, we've got millions of people. Millions of people. And I guess I don't blame them. They want to get over here and get taken care of and get health insurance. And some of them, they can even get a driver's license and everything. They ain't even Americans. I mean, there's millions of them right now. And they're trying, the government's trying to build a wall now to keep them out. And that's a big issue right now in government. So the safety net is good, but this widow didn't have any safety net. And we have it in America, even for those that aren't Americans. And by the way, that costs us lots and lots and lots of money. taxpayers pay a lot. It was tax day yesterday, you know, the 17th, and so they had to have your taxes filed by yesterday, the 17th. So, and there was a widow, and saying, "Avenge me of mine adversary," and he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, "Though I fear not God," and he said he didn't fear God, and nor regarded man, didn't care about men, didn't care about them people came before him, and he was a judge, shame on him, shouldn't have been a judge. "Yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me." Now this is telling us about the world system. The world system is this. If you make a complaint, you might make it once. You might make it again the third time. But you know, that's the way you get stuff done, to complain, to keep after them. Am I telling you the truth or not?
The squeaky wheel gets the grease.
The squeaky wheel gets the oil. Yeah. I had a, and I was like this widow. I think I had a just complaint. It didn't matter what the situation was or where it was or whatever. But it was something where a certain organization did not handle me properly. And tried to charge me $50. Doesn't matter what it was or who it was or whatever. And I saw that it didn't do right. And I talked to a couple of people in that organization. So then I just called up and said, "Would you have the owner call me?" "Oh, you mean the owner?" "Yeah, that's the one I want to talk to." "Well, could you talk to his assistant?" "No. No, I won't talk to the boss man. I've already talked to a couple of people." "Well, I talked to the owner, and he was sweet as pie, and I got the thing taken care of, and he apologized for the way I wasn't treated right in the first place, and he says they should never have done that, and the $50, forget about that $50. "But now, why did that happen?" You say, "Well, a Christian shouldn't do that." I disagree with you. I don't think someone say a Christian has no rights. I don't believe in that. Saul of Tarsus, he demanded certain rights, you know, when he was arrested, remember, because he was a Roman. And he asked the captain, he says, "How did you get your Roman citizenship?" He had to pay a lot of money. He says, I was born a Roman. Yeah, I was born a Roman. So, he said, "You've got to take me to the right jurisdiction. You can't put me aside." So even Paul, the great apostle Paul, in the Bible, he had certain things. But in this world, if you state what you want, and if you don't get it, you can do it again. But I mean, it's a right cause. Paul had a right cause. I had a right cause, and not have to pay this $50 The owner of the establishment says, "We didn't pay the $50, did not?" "No, I didn't pay it. That's why I'm talking to you." "I'm paying it." I wouldn't go to court on him or anything, but if he would explain to me reasonably and logically that I didn't have a just cause and I owed him $50, I'd give him the $50, but he didn't. But you see what this parable is teaching is, as Joe said, the squeaky wheel gets the grease. The squeaky wheel gets the oil. And this judge says, I don't fear God. I don't care about man. And she keeps bothering me. This woman ain't going to quit. I'm tired of seeing her face. Okay. And he granted in her favor. So let's go on now in this little teaching on prayer. Because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. Judge is getting worn out. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge say. Now, this was a lousy judge, didn't fear God, didn't fear man. Look at verse 7. And shall not God, the God of glory, avenge his own elect? That's a saved person. It doesn't mean like the Calvinist teacher, the fatalist teach that there are certain people elected for heaven and you can't do anything about it, and there are certain people, the rest of the chumps are going to hell and they can't do nothing about it. That's foolishness. That's false doctrine to the nth degree. This Calvinism or this fatalism that says there's only a few people going to heaven and God's ordained everyone going to go to hell, all the rest. It's not sustainable at all. It's not backed up with the Bible at all. But a lot of high-minded and misled people follow the teachings of John Calvin and other teachers that teach that the elect are... You're going to go to heaven if you're going to go, and you're going to go to hell if you're going to go, and you got nothing to say about it. They never give an invitation. They never try to get anybody saved. Why would they? I mean, if people are elected for heaven or hell, why would you try to get anybody saved? You wouldn't have to, because it's all signed, sealed, and delivered. They dispute that, but that's what it is. All right. And shall not God avenge his own elect, that's you and I, saved people, which cry day and night unto him. See, when does God want us to cry out to him? Day and night. Another portion of Scripture says, pray without ceasing. I love to be alone with God. I met God in the morning, amen, early in the morning, when my day was at its best. And his presence came like sunrise, like a glory in my breast. All day long his presence lingered. All day long he stayed with me. And we sailed with perfect calmness o'er a very troubled sea. Other ships were blown and battered. Other ships were sore distressed. But the winds that seemed to drive them brought to me a peace and rest. Oh, the calmness of God. So I thought of other mornings with a keen remorse of mind when I too had left the moorings with the presence left behind. So I think I know the secret learned from many a troubled way. You must meet God in the morning if you want him through the day. Oh, my, that's, you know, you meet him in the morning and you stick with him during the day and you pray and go to sleep with him, you have some good dreams then. You won't have nightmares then. I don't have nightmares. I can't remember. I took a certain kind of pill once. I must have messed with my psyche or something. And I had a bad dream. A doctor prescribed it. I don't know what it was or what anything. And I took the one pill, went to sleep that night, and I had a weird dream, you know, a troubling dream. I got up the next morning. I says, honey, I ain't taking one of them pills. And I guess sometimes them medicine can make you screw you up or something like that. I don't know, but that's the only time it happened to me. But I don't have bad dreams. I sleep good. I dream about preaching. I dream about this. I dream good things. And why? If you walk with God, you're not going to have nightmares. How can you be in the presence of God and be terrorized? How can you be in the presence of God and be fearful? Think about it, church, you that are here tonight and you that are out there in Facebook. I tell you, verse 8, he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, look, here's the end of it. Now, nevertheless, when the Son of Man, capital S, that's Jesus, cometh, this is him speaking here, actually, shall he find faith on the earth? You see, God, he's not finding the faith that he should find. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. We started out in our text this evening, Luke 18, 1. Then he gave the parable about the unjust judge and the widow that came to him and would not stop. And he got tired of her coming and he granted. And he says, how much more? How much more? Oh, I love it. I love it. And shall God not avenge his own elect, we that are saved? Oh, how wonderful that is. Which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them. I tell you, he will avenge them speedily. You just be getting prayer answered. Answer prayer. Answer prayer. Answer prayer. Answer prayer. That's what I want. Answer prayer. I've seen so many prayers answered over. My faith is building as I see, and I've got prayers now. I'm just foolish enough as an old man to believe my best days of ministry are in front of me, not behind me. I'm not going to sit around and say, oh man, I remember back when God did this and all this. No, I say, do it again, Lord, and do more. Amen?
Yeah, yeah.
If we still got breath in us, and we to go to him, and men ought always to pray and not to faint, and he'll avenge us speedily. But it says here, nevertheless, when the Son of Man, Jesus talking about himself, capital S Son, cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? See, God is not finding faith. Christians don't pray. We sing, we have big things. I seen a brochure. I'm not trying to be. I won't even tell you the name of the church. It's a local church here. I won't tell you the name of it or anything. But it was from last Christmas. It was a Christmas and New Year's brochure. I saw it yesterday. By the way, I don't believe in Christmas anyway. I don't believe in Christmas. Bessie, now this is a church, supposed to be evangelical church, pretty big church. It had pictures of Santa Claus on there. It had pictures of Christmas cookies. It had a picture with fireworks and everything. It says, Giant New Year's Eve Celebration. You might be able to figure out which church it is. You'd think a little bit. Brad's figured it out. I think you got it. You got it figured out, Brad? You got it figured out? He says a lot of churches come to mind. I guess sad to say there is. But, I mean, Christmas never was a Bible holiday of remembering the birth of Christ. The only time the birth of Christ was made a big deal of is when he was born. That was it. We make a yearly, it's okay, I don't mind that. But Santa Claus and the reindeers and he sees you when you're sleeping. Oh, shut up. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake. Oh, you better watch out. Oh, they sing that. And they got Santa Claus in the church today and on and on and the Christmas cookies and the punch nothing on that brochure exalted Christ and the Savior. It was just all about big time holiday celebration. Now that's terrible. God doesn't care about that kind of stuff. But he cares about winning souls. He cares about doing it. And so we have big concerts and we have big parties and we have big events and many churches, they wonder what kind of a bigger event they can have this week that they had bigger than last week. Instead of just getting with God, shall he find faith on the earth? Is he going to find faith in our church? Is he going to find some people that want to be with him? Is he going to find some people that care about fellowship with the Lord and will this key kickoff that Jesus had, 18:1, and he spake and he gave this parable that men ought always to pray and not to faint, praying without ceasing. We had prayer meeting. We have prayer meeting tonight. We have prayer meeting on Sunday night and Wednesday night. You don't have prayer meetings anywhere. 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70. Started a New Testament church, Acts 1:8. Jesus, he said, you shall be endued with power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you and shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria, and uttermost parts of the world. And he said, tarry till you get the power. We laid 120 in the church. What did they do? They had upper room prayer meeting, didn't they? They were of one accord. The whole church, the men, the women, the whole bunch, the church is praying. And it says after 10 days, the Holy Ghost power came down. 3,000 were saved and baptized and added to the church. Why? They had a prayer meeting. Amen. We used to have prayer meetings. Not prayer meetings anymore. And I used to remember. I remembered years ago when I was a kid, the old time Pentecostals. I'm not a tongues talking Pentecostal. I don't believe in the modern day tongues movement. My mother and father were part of it. They were Assemblies of God missionaries, and my dad pastored a church for a year or so. He had to fill in. We went to Pennsylvania, Friedmundburg, Pennsylvania, and I've been to a lot of churches. I didn't get saved till I was 29, but when I was a kid, I used to go to them things they'd start church at 7 o'clock in the morning and be there 7, 8, 9, 10 o'clock at night. I mean, they'd have a Sunday school, they'd have church, and then they'd have dinner, and they'd baptize people in the afternoon, and they'd sing, and they'd pray, and all of that. And the Pentecostals would do it, and the Methodists would do it, and the Baptists would do it, and the others would do it, and all of these. Now, there's a lot of different churches that name the name of Christ. We like to call them a lot of times now evangelical churches and whatever, so forth. But, you know, we don't hardly have any churches today, whether they be Pentecostal or Baptist or Methodist or what is called evangelical or Bible churches or whatever. No one has prayer meetings anymore. How about it out there? I see some people are witching it tonight. They're in ministry and things, and you got prayer meetings at your church? I don't know. Not many. We got out. I'm not saying we've arrived, but I'm going to work at it. We've got out on our marquee out in the front. It says House of Prayer. Amen. And we got prayer at 5 o'clock on Sunday night and 5 o'clock on Wednesday night. Not many people come. We've got some faithful few come, and that's wonderful. I hope to see more. When the Holy Ghost power came in the book of Acts, the whole church was there, 120, praying for 10 days. Huh? Them disciples there in the New Testament, remember when the man brought his son to Jesus and said his disciples couldn't cast, he's got demons, his disciples couldn't take care of it. He cast demons out. And he bawled out his disciples. He said, "You don't have any faith. How could we get this?" they said. And he said, This kind cometh out not but by prayer and fasting. You got something in your life here in church tonight? You got something this kind? I've got some of this kind things in my life. Everybody does. The only way we're going to get our prayers answered for the tough ones, the this kind, is by prayer and fasting. We don't even have prayer meetings. We can't get people to pray for any amount of time. When's the last time you heard of an all-night prayer meeting? Jesus did it all the time. Sometimes I just pray on through the night. I just get something on my heart or mind, and I'll just pray. I might look a little sleepy. I don't talk about it. I don't come running in here in the morning and say, "I've been up all night praying." I might look a little sleepy. I might doze off that afternoon. But I prayed all night. I'd like to see sometime. We used to have, it could be, I know some preachers that they, of course, we got these telephones now, and they would have a prayer meeting. I think they might still do it. Some missionaries and some pastors. I don't know. Forgive me. I didn't know the guys really. I know one guy in the group. But I guess I'll just admit it. I'm probably too lazy to join them. They had a certain night they met on, and they prayed all night. The Bible says confess your sins one to another. Amen. I guess probably. My problem was I wasn't up to it, amen? I just didn't have all-night praying in me. I've done it myself sometime. I'd rather do it myself. I think private prayer is the best because you're always... You know why I think private prayer is the best? Because you're always with yourself. That's a no-brainer, isn't it? You don't ever have to worry about that because you're always carrying yourself around with you. And the Bible says we should pray without ceasing. And Jesus said here in this parable, and he spake a parable, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. But he doesn't find faith. We won't pray. Our prayers will be answered because of our faith. How do we get faith? We ask God for it. He'll upbraid us, and he'll give us faith if we ask for it. And the other way you get faith is faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We need to get more Bible preaching done. My wife always, and she's probably right, but I know a lot of great preachers that tell stories. And, well, I mean, I'm going to just protect myself right now. Jesus was a great preacher, wasn't he? He just told us, we just read a story tonight about the unjust judge and the widow, didn't he? So if Jesus told stories, I can tell stories. See, I got a couple of preachers watching tonight. You can tell stories too, preacher. That's okay. I can too. And it is. And Brother Hiles always used to tell me, well, he'd say that he had to tell his stories to, he had to tell stories. He said, if you preach all Bible, most of your people will fall asleep. He says, you got to tell them stories, because only really perk up when you tell them stories. They like stories and simple ones, you know. And that's what he said. I got to tell you stories to keep you awake. Then I try to sneak in a little Bible on you once in a while, you know. We've got such a carnal church. He said it then, and it's true now. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, and he could come every day, any day now, shall he find faith on the earth? You know, in 1 John chapter 2, John said that he didn't want to be ashamed when Jesus come back. If Jesus come back right now, and I'm preaching and you're in church and people are watching on Facebook church, I think we'd be more comfortable than if we were watching some stupid thing on television, huh? Or downloading a movie or doing something frivial and like Charles Finney names a big long list of things called innocent amusements. Christians are all involved in innocent amusements. And it could be anything. It could be hunting and fishing. It could be football. It could be baseball. It could be bird watching. It could be bug collecting. It could be anything. It could be anything. But our main focus should be on God and be in his presence. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. And it told here in our parable today a story that Jesus told. I'm going to tell my wife tonight. I read one of Jesus' stories tonight when I preached. I read one of Jesus' stories, a parable about the unjust judge and about the widow that because of her continued coming, the judge answered him. He didn't want to be bothered no more. I preached a story about the prodigal son. What was that? It was in 16, a couple chapters ahead. I kind of preached through the Bible. Don't always. But I kind of like to follow a pattern going through, and we're reading in these chapters right now, getting through the Bible in a year. 14 minutes a day, you read the whole Bible in a year if you stick at it. But in the parable of the prodigal son, it said this about the prodigal son. I preached about it on, what did I preach about? A few days ago, I don't remember what day. Maybe last Thursday. Sunday I preached about. No, that was 16. I preached on the rich man Lazarus on Sunday. But the prodigal son, when he came to himself and he turned and he came to the father, when he came there with a repentant heart and humbled himself, it said the father ran to him and hugged him and got the best robe and put it on him. Huh? And killed the fatted calf. Amen. I like the fatted calf. Not as much as I used to. I used to like it more. I can't eat as much beef as I used to. I like the prime rib, and I like the ribeye, porterhouse. That's called the not the skinny cow, but the fatted calf. That's the good one, because fat's where it's at when you're eating meat, right? I mean that the fat, that's the taste of that thing. And I eat that all down through my years, all these years I've been married. I get that fatted stuff and My wife always says, cut that fat off, put it on the side. I said, oh, no, you think I'm gonna cut off the best part of this? I'll take that oozing fat from the prime rib or the porterhouse, and I just chew on that baby and swallow it down. He killed the fatted calf. We were lost and now we're found. You turn to God and repent, he'll run to you and hug your neck. Isn't that wonderful? He'll answer you quickly. That's what he'll do. He's not like the unjust judge where you have to bother him to death. Now, some things you have to pray longer for than others. But shall he find faith on the earth? How's your faith? How's your faith? Another friend just tuned in. How's your faith? We're in Luke 18 for those that are just coming in on Facebook. And we've read verses 1 through 8. The widow and the unjust judge. What a wonderful story, a parable that Jesus told. She kept coming back and she kept bothering that judge till he said, okay, quit bothering me. I don't want to be bothered anymore. Go ahead, you can have your way. I'll agree with you against your adversary. What it says here in our scripture, and shall not God. Verse 6, and the Lord saith, Jesus speaking here, hear what the unjust judge saith, and shall not God avenge his own elect, save people like you and I, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them. I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Oh, yes, he'll answer our prayer. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? Will you have faith tonight out there? Facebook folks and folks in church tonight here. Will you have faith in God? He'll answer you. All of our failures, church, all of our failures, Facebook, our prayer failures. You worry, you fret, you watch worldly television, you go to worldly parties, you live like the world, and you're lonesome all the time, and you're always looking for a friend to be around you. Oh, I love it. I love it. What a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, I love it. Let's find it. Let's say it. Find it in your hymnals there. Sing it. What a friend. Get with him. Stay in his presence. Praise God. What page is it on? What a friend we have. 155. That ain't it. The wrong number. Why did I say 155? Maybe the wrong number. Not in here. 355. I don't know. 355. It's in here. Sing it. Facebook, you sing it too. You know it by heart. Most of you do. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Shame on us. Shame on us, Christian brothers and sisters. Shame on us. We worry and we fret. Figure, what was it? Dr. Walter Wilson, he was a medical doctor and is also a preacher. And in his office, in his medical office, he was back in the 50s, probably Dr. Wilson, he had a sign on his wall in his office, and it said, "Why pray when you can worry?" Why pray? That's your deal, isn't it, Facebook? Why pray when you just worry about something? Call up on the telephone. Tell everybody your troubles. Say, "Oh my, I don't know what I'm gonna do. I don't know what I'm gonna do." Why don't you get with God and let Him do something about it? Amen. Yeah, what a friend we have in Jesus. These are words. You preach a sermon off of this song. All our sins and griefs to bear. We need to get rid of our sins. Anybody done any sinning today? I haven't. You think I'm lying to you? Listen, I'm going to have to think a little bit. Today, I'm not aware. You know, sometimes, some days, have you done that out there, Facebook friends and these people that are here at church today? Let me say this. Sometimes, as a Christian, do you really do a stupid sin that's kind of haunting you all day long? Have you ever done that? I've done it. I mean, I've done that one. I didn't do that today. I didn't say I didn't sin today. But some of them blatant ones where you really go off the trolley, you know what I'm talking about, and you really mess up. And what you need to do is get down on your face before God and repent. And you carry it up, and hopefully you confess it before you go to bed at night. But all our sins and griefs to bear, He'll take it. I mean, you see, you can't get close to Him. You got sin in your life. You got beer in your icebox. You got cigarettes in your pocket or in your purse, and you got animosity and hatred in your heart. It told us today, we preached this morning in the 17th chapter. It says you ought to keep forgiving people. Keep forgiving them and forgive them. And a lot of people, there's people out there on Facebook watching tonight, and there's people here maybe. You got animosity. If a certain person's name was mentioned, it might have been from 20 years in your past. You have hatred for that person. You can't keep that. You can't come to God and get answers to prayer if you've got hatred against folks and all that stuff. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Don't you hold back a thing. Confess your sin. Break down the wall of separation between you and God. If you're not saved, get saved. Get saved if you're not saved. Everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often... Don't forfeit your peace. You worry and trouble and you've got to get on the phone. You've got to go see someone. Oh, I just got to talk to you. No, my Lord. How sad. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. What you going to do? The Bible starts out in Luke 18:1. Jesus said, told a parable about the unjust judge and the widow woman. Said that's mankind, men and women, ought always to pray and not to faint. All of our failures are prayer failures. Don't you forget that. Don't you forget that, church. Don't you forget that, Facebook. All of our failures are prayer failures. We can get into the presence of God and lay our burden, and He'll like to. We were watching a few of these videos here, and that country singer was singing about their tears and wanted the Lord to. Take care of you. We can go to, I mean, how foolish we are. How foolish we are. Let's see what that second verse says. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. And the last, are we weak and heavy laden? Cumbered with a load of care. precious Savior, still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find the solace there. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you that we've been encouraged tonight by the blessed Savior. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. Everybody, man, woman, boy, girl, whoever, pray. Pray without ceasing. Oh, he longs to be with us. He longs to fellowship with us. He's so able. He's able to deliver us. He is able to deliver us. Praise God. I love these old songs of the faith. Lord, I'm sick of these little ditties they sing today that just so you can tap your feet and dance to it, and it don't make no sense. Call it Christian music. You give me what a friend we have in Jesus. Give me He is able. Give me these old, the newer songs can be written too that have good words, Bible words, but this song tells a story. Help us to bring it to you. Is there someone out in Facebook? I believe everyone here at church is saved tonight. I know the people here tonight. Anybody not saved, why don't you give your heart to Christ tonight? Why don't you repent? You don't know you're going to heaven. You've never been born again. You might be a church member. You might have quit a few things. You might have been baptized, joined the church. But you've never been born again. Oh, you know if you're born again. If you're not, you need to repent and be saved. Receive Christ. This is a sinner's prayer. Pray it. Heavenly Father, I believe that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sins of the world and shed his blood on Calvary's cross and raised from the grave the third day. And the best I know how, I turned from my sins and I received Christ as my Savior. I received the gift of eternal life. Nothing to do with the church. Nothing to do with baptism. Nothing to do with good works. But calling upon thee to save me. Please save me now. I hope there are those that have done that never done it before. On the authority of the Word of God, the promise is, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Nothing to do with any denomination, nothing to do with any baptism, nothing to do with any good works. Just repenting and believing and receiving. As many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even them believe upon his name. Thank you, Lord. And now, dear Lord, we that are Christians, I believe the majority watching on Facebook, some preachers even watching, Lord, we that are here in church, forgive us for our lack of prayer. When you come, will you find faith? Will we be praying? Will we even leave this church service tonight, or will we leave this watching it on Facebook tonight? Will we be with thee in prayer? Will we pillow our heads tonight in prayer? In fellowship with God, speaking to him, giving him our fears and our anxiety. All your anxieties, all your cares, take them to Jesus and leave them there. Oh, never a burden he will not. Whoa, what a wonderful song. I don't remember all the names, but they got all these wonderful songs about prayer. We need to pray. Dear church member, myself included here, dear folks out in Facebook, let's dedicate ourselves afresh and anew to prayer. Change us tonight to be men and women of prayer. People of prayer. Let your house be called a house of prayer, where you live and where you go to church. May we walk with God and pray. Forgive us for our foolishness and our anxious care and our lack of coming to you and bringing all of our burdens to you and all of our cares to the mercy seat. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. It's been a good meeting tonight. Thank you, Lord. Bless us. Help us to make decisions that will last now. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, church. God bless you, Facebook. Let's start praying. Let's change this city. You're only going to do it through prayer. Not going to be anything else. Can't do it through trying to conjure it up, but through prayer, and the Holy Ghost of God will do it for us. God bless you. We'll be on tomorrow about 10 o'clock in the morning.